There's no doubt that what is about to come, the poetry of Paradiso, is the most difficult to appreciate in the whole of the comedy. The violence and drama of hell is easy to get into. There we found sinners in any manner of position frozen within ice. We saw Dante snap a twig and heard a voice gurgle up through the bloody wound. We read with vertigo about the wild ride of Geryon. In Purgatorio, we heard about the heavy rocks carried by the proud, the punishment of the French bakery for the gluttonous, the absolute tranquility of the garden, as well as the shocking apocalyptic appearance of Beatrice and the final canti of that canticle. The Paradiso, though, is something different. It's much less dramatic. And it's harder to locate the action, because it doesn't unfold in a mud pit or in a spooky forest or at the top of a breezy mountain. Rather, the speakers themselves form the background, and their speeches constitute the drama. Paradiso, you could say, is brighter and higher pitched, and so much more abstract. The fact is, Dante himself was aware of the difficulty of his final canticle, so much so that he even urges his readers in Paradiso 2 to quit now, before it's too late. Oh, you eager to hear more, who have followed in your little bark, my ship that singing makes its way, turn back if you would see your shores again. Do not set forth upon the deep, for losing sight of me, you would be lost. The seas I sail were never sailed before. Minerva fills my sail, Apollo is my guide. 9 muses point me toward the bears. You other few who craned your necks in time to reach for angels' bread, which gives us life on earth, yet never leaves us satisfied, you may indeed set out your ship afloat upon the salty deep, keeping to the furrow I have made before the sea goes smooth again. Those famous men who made their way to Colchis when they saw Jason had become a plowman were not as stunned as you shall be. It's not a very good marketing scheme, is it? Dear reader, please put this book down now, because you can't handle what's to come. I've often wanted to test this technique out on my college students to see what happens. Okay, from now on, every single class will be optional, because the content we will encounter will be so difficult you will only understand it with great effort, and because the words and thoughts are just simply too beautiful. Dante says that he only wants a few readers, and those most desirous, those who, quote, few who crane their necks, to reach for angels' bread, which gives us life on earth, yet never leaves us satisfied. Only those who pant and thirst for adventure, like the legendary heroes who accompanied Jason in the pursuit of the Golden Fleece. If you don't have fire in your heart, Dante says, there will be no point in reading on. Just turn back so that you don't suffer shipwreck. But if it just so happens that you're ready, really ready, if you are truly bold, then, quote, those famous men who made their way to Colchis were not as stunned as you shall be. Dante alludes to the Argonauts, who watched their captain crush up the teeth of a magical serpent and plow them into the ground. From this unusual sowing, a group of warriors sprang up who killed one another. Dante says you will be more amazed than they were. Dante's following a well-tested medieval technique and slowly increasing the difficulty of his writings. In Boethius's famous Consolation of Philosophy, which we know that Dante knew well, Lady Philosophy, noticing that her patient is in a kind of spiritual coma, says that she'll have to employ a multi-step plan for healing. Have I made change the metaphor slightly? Philosophy has to first stop the bleeding, then put on a bandage, before she can eventually attempt philosophical open-heart surgery. Lady Philosophy tells Boethius in this imaginative dialogue, quote, you're not ready for strong medicines, I'm afraid. So we'll begin with something milder, anodynes, so that the sore and angry places may be softened and soothed. Then we can perhaps begin the real treatment, end quote. Similarly, Augustine in his Confessions begins by telling first the narrative of his life, his conversion, and his sins, before he ends up talking about the nature and meaning of memory, the relationship between time and eternity, and then turns to a commentary on the opening chapters of Genesis. Thus Dante, Augustine, and Boethius all work a little bit like Beethoven did in the Ninth Symphony, which begins bold and dramatic with contrasting chords and a fast-paced tempo, until the music climbs in the final movement, not only into the joyous outburst of the joyful joyful, but also in notes which are so high that they even test the best sopranos. Beethoven, the old deaf musician who had to cut the legs of his piano and then lie on his belly to feel the vibrations of the notes through the floor, was barely writing music which could be sung by human vocal cords. We should think of Dante's Paradiso like that, as notes sung so high that the pilgrim can almost not hear them. But what's remarkable is that the only reason he can hear their words at all is because the saints in heaven condescend to speak at his level. The souls in heaven momentarily hold back their glory, lest it blind him. This, then, is the remarkable fact, that the saints use baby talk, babbling so that the pilgrim can halfway understand them. But from the pilgrim's perspective, it's the most extreme and intense speech he's ever heard. In paradise, Dante has the maturity of a spiritual infant. According to medieval understandings of the experience of beauty, Dante's work achieves such an intensity of power because all of the ingredients, though blended together, all retain such high contrast. The fact that hell is so deep and dark, the fact that Dante tries to use the language of broken glass and fingernails on the chalkboard, the fact that by the end of the journey we're almost spiritually broken, prepares us for an equally overwhelming experience of heaven. The depths of hell prepares us for the abyss of heaven. If this all seems too intense, note the allusion the poet uses in Paradiso 1. O good Apollo, enter my breast and breathe in me, as when you drew out Marsyas, out from the sheathing of his limbs. The image, of course, is the brutal death of the mythological Marsyas, the musician who was so recklessly bold that he challenged Apollo to a competition. When he inevitably lost to Apollo, Marsyas was flayed alive, a gruesome death which was famously portrayed by the Venetian painter Titian. And this is the story Dante uses to invite the kind of inspiration he thinks he needs. Dante calls for a violent inspiration, one so profound that he's stripped of himself, drawn out of himself, an inspiration according to which he radically leaves the limitations of his mortal humanity behind. Well, perhaps it strikes you as a little strange that we have all this talk about the failure and limitations of language coming now, two-thirds of the way through a 1,000-page book. Well, all of this concern with ineffability is proof that Dante is here engaging the Christian and classical traditions of mysticism, or more particularly, negative theology. Now, many of my students are not accustomed to thinking about mysticism or negative theology as proper to Christianity. Mysticism seems like some vaguely Eastern phenomenon, something which belongs to Hinduism or Buddhism. But the truth is, Christianity inherited its mysticism from both Greeks and Jews, and ever since the Church Fathers, such as Gregory of Nyssa, speaking of the unknowability of God has been an important teaching. If you're interested in learning more about this, then I recommend a book which came out from CUA Press in 2004 by Gregory Rocca, Speaking the Incomprehensible God, which is all about Aquinas' inheritance and transformation of this tradition. But there are even hints of such a tradition within Scripture. For instance, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, St. Paul modestly alludes to some mysterious vision he was given. This is a passage which is all over the first two kanji of Paradiso. He says, I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago, whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell, God knoweth. Such an one caught up to the third heaven. And I knew such a man, how that he was caught up into paradise, and heard unspeakable words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. Paul's word for unspeakable is aretos, the equivalent of ineffabilis, whence we get our own English, ineffable. A 6th century Byzantine theologian by the name of Dionysius the Areopagite picked up on this passage in St. Paul and purported to explain what this mysterious vision was and how we too can come to enjoy it. His writings were translated into Latin in the early 9th century, after which time they influenced numerous theologians, such as Hugh and Richard of St. Victor, both mentioned in Dante, as well as the great Thomas Aquinas. In fact, if you go open up your copy of the Summa Theologica and reread the first 13 questions, pay attention to the author cited more times than any other in this section. It's Dionysius the Areopagite. Well, as you can imagine, these are the kinds of teachings which cannot be easily or quickly communicated. But I at least want to provide some background of mystical theology before we return to the opening of the Paradiso. In particular, I'll refer to a short 5-page treatise by Dionysius the Areopagite, already mentioned, called by some the father of Christian mysticism. As I mentioned, Aquinas not only knew him, but wrote a commentary on his treatise on the divine names. So let's turn to this short little treatise called The Mystical Theology for a bit of background. Dionysius puts it quite simply. God is the cause of all and, quote, the cause of all is above all. Because God is above all, then the language we routinely use about this world, about his creatures, is radically deficient when we try to use it in reference to God. For example, take this use of the word is. We can say that there is no such thing as a unicorn. There is no unicorn. But there is such a thing as a horse. Or some man called Trevor is. When we say this, we mean that this creature lives and has being. At the same time, if we dig a little deeper, although this horse or man is, we also understand that it doesn't necessarily have to be. We could imagine a world without horses, or a world without the man named Trevor. And so although it exists, or is, what we mean by that is something more like this. This creature has being, but not of necessity. Its being is on loan to it for a short time. Now, when we turn back to talking about God, we begin to realize the radical limitations of our words. We just said that when we use the word is, most of the time we're using it for creatures which are radically contingent, that is, which don't have to exist at all. Thus, when we utter the seemingly straightforward sentence, God is, we think we know what we mean. But the problem is, we're trying to use the same word that we used for creatures of dust, for that being who cannot not be. Thus, by applying our language ordinarily used to talk about creatures to God, we run the risk of imprisoning His majesty within the cage of our own language. Dionysius makes this very argument, but he uses a rhetoric which is much more full of paradox and mystery. Quote, "The more I climb in my speech, the more language falters, and when it has passed up beyond the ascent, it will turn silent completely." Dionysius says then that the closer we get to God, the less our words mean anything when applied to Him. We're thus left with feeling that our words are babble and chatter. We're reduced to silence. In the same section, Dionysius says, quote, "The fact is, the more we take flight upward, the more our words are confined to the ideas we are capable of forming. So that now as we plunge into darkness which is beyond intellect, we shall find ourselves not simply running short of words, but actually speechless and unknowing." End quote. Based on this observation, Dionysius says that it's better for us to say what God is not, rather than trying to say what God is. In this way, we become like sculptors who carve away everything which could obstruct our view of what God is. Quote, "We would be like sculptors who set out to carve a statue. They remove every obstacle to the pure view of the hidden image, and simply by this act of clearing aside, they show us the beauty which is hidden." End quote. In this way, Dionysius says, you have to strive to leave everything behind, to recognize the radical limitations of your words for talking about God. "My advice to you," he says, "is to leave behind you everything perceived and understood, everything perceptible and understandable, all that is and all that is not. And with your understanding laid aside, to strive upward as much as you can toward union with Him who is beyond all being and knowledge." End quote. Later, Dionysius uses the example of Moses climbing up Mount Sinai into darkness. He urges his readers to leave behind the knowing of language and plunge into divine darkness. "The good cause of all," he says, is on a plane above all this, and it's made manifest only to those who travel through foul and fair, who pass beyond the summit of every holy ascent, who leave behind them every divine light, every voice, every word from heaven, and who plunge into the darkness where, as Scripture proclaims, there dwells the one who's beyond all things. With all of this discussion of plunging into divine darkness, we can turn back to Dante. In the opening three tazzine to the Paradiso, he refers to this getting lost within God. The third canticle begins in this way. The glory of him who moves all things, pervades the universe and shines in one part more and in another less. I was in that heaven which receives more of his light. He who comes down from there can neither know nor tell what he has seen. For drawing near to its desire, so deeply is our intellect immersed that memory cannot follow after it. Later, Dante adds, to soar beyond the human cannot be described in words. Let the example be enough to one for whom grace holds this experience in store. Throughout the opening verses of the Paradiso, we see Dante taking St. Paul as his patron saint, as it were. You remember the words I quoted from Paul about how he was uncertain about whether he was taken up into heaven in the body or out of the body, and how he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words which is not lawful for a man to utter. Well, Dante alludes to this passage when he says, whether I was there in that part only which you created last is known to you alone, O love who ruled the heavens and drew me up there with your light. Dante's own uncertainty over what exactly his journey was echoes the uncertainty of the scriptural passage. Thus, as a pilgrim, as a man on a spiritual journey, Dante follows the example of St. Paul. He also follows Paul in suggesting that what he saw and experienced is beyond the ability of language to capture. But all of this, that is the fact that Dante claims to have gone to a place beyond intellect, beyond memory, beyond language, presents a major problem for a poet. A problem more intense than any he has so far faced. Poets are supposed to talk about things, right? And thus, to our surprise, we find Dante, at the same time he claims his subject is ineffable, at the exact same time he takes St. Paul as his patron, he also turns to the classical tradition for inspiration to speak about what he saw. And thus, in the beginning of Paradiso, we have two long traditions colliding, that of the mystic, whose vision ends in silence, and that of the classical poet who strives to craft his language. Thus, in addition to being a St. Paul, Dante wants also to be, at the exact same time, an Orpheus, the legendary poet who could tame beasts and bend trees to the sweetness of his verse. And finally, Dante will lay one more layer on top of all this. He depicts himself as a great classical hero who goes and steals something of great worth and then brings it home again, like Jason and the Golden Fleece. And we hear all of the strands of these interweaving traditions in his opening invocation. Having just mentioned the failure of memory and words, Dante continues, nevertheless, as much of the Holy Kingdom as I could store as treasure in my mind shall now become the subject of my song. Dante makes himself out to be some kind of adventurous hero from a fairy tale who climbs up a ladder and steals some minuscule part of the giant's treasure. Or perhaps like Prometheus, who stole just a spark and banked it and brought it back home to Earth. But Dante's convinced that given the extraordinary nature of the treasure of that kingdom, the joy experienced through looking at and being seen by God, that if he could just get a flicker of it, one tiny little spark, and if he could somehow get it back home to Earth and get that into his poem, then the whole world would be consumed with the flame of love. Or as he says, poca favilla gran fiamma seconda, a great fire leaps from the smallest spark. It's for this reason that Dante prays and begs with such urgency. Dante invokes God. He invokes the Holy Spirit. He invokes the ancient muses. He calls upon Apollo, as if calling upon anyone who will listen to enable him to capture just a glimmer of the heavenly kingdom. Nevertheless, as much of the Holy Kingdom as I could store as treasure in my mind shall now become the subject of my song. O good Apollo, for this last labor make me into a vessel worthy of the gift of your beloved laurel. Up to this point, one peak of Mount Parnassus has been enough, but now I need them both in order to confront the struggle that awaits. Enter my breast and breathe in me as when you drew out Marsyas out from the sheathing of his limbs. O holy power, if you but lend me of yourself enough that I may show the merest shadow of the blessed kingdom stamped within my mind, you shall find me at the foot of your beloved tree, crowning myself with the very leaves of which my theme and you will make me worthy. So rarely, Father, are they gathered to mark the triumph of a Caesar or a poet, fault and shame of human wishes, that anyone's even longing for them, those leaves on the Paeonian bough, should make the joyous Delphic god give birth to joy. Great fire leaps from the smallest spark. Poca favilla gran fiamma seconda. And so we have a gap between the ambition of the poet and the unspeakability, the ineffability of the place into which he ventures. He wants, like Jason, to steal some object of great price and bring it home again. But his human faculty to carry it home in language is hardly capable of such an adventurous undertaking. And so what is the pilgrim to do? But there's an even deeper problem, and that is the pilgrim's inability to even see the depths of what he later hopes to write about. Dante represents this almost right away in Paradiso I, when the pilgrim, inspired by Beatrice, turns to look at the sun. Against our practice, I set my eyes upon the sun. Much that our powers here cannot sustain is there allowed by the virtue of the nature of the place, created as the dwelling fit for man. I could not bear it long, yet not so brief a time as not to see it sparking everywhere like liquid iron flowing from the fire. Looking at the sun, then, is the perfect image for Dante's journey into heaven. Ordinarily, the sun's so bright that it makes you blind. If you look at the source of sight too much, then it will take away your sight. And thus, for a medieval man who loves so much the splendor of shining gems and the radiance of natural light, or the dazzling colors of stained glass, or the crystalline beauty of the stars, it was a bit of a shame that human powers were not fully capable of enjoying the most beautiful natural object in the world, the sun. But in heaven, as Dante says, you're given more power to see, more power than you have here. And we will see, too, that as the pilgrim progresses through the stages of heaven, his power of sight will grow stronger and stronger, so that in the end, he'll be able to stare at an image of brilliance which is more than 1,000 times brighter than the sun. But Dante also gives us a precious hint as to what that instrument is which develops his sight. In other words, how is it the case that what blinds the pilgrim and sears his eyes with pain will later delight him? How does his vision get stronger? For Dante, it's love. Love adds to our capacity to see. Take a look at the passage which follows immediately after the one I just quoted. That is, after Dante describes how he had a brief moment in which he could look at the sun before his eyes began to mist over. I could not bear it long. Yet not so brief a time as not to see the sun sparking everywhere like liquid iron flowing from the fire. Suddenly it seemed a day was added to that day, as if the one who had the power had adorned the heavens with a second sun. Beatrice had fixed her eyes upon the eternal wheels, and I now fixed my sight on her, withdrawing it from above. As I gazed on her, I was changed within, as Glaucus was on tasting of the grass that made him consort of the gods in the sea. To soar beyond the human cannot be described in words. Let the example be enough to one for whom grace holds this experience in store. Dante, having just withdrawn his eyes from the sun, looks down, but to his surprise, there's a new sun, as it were, blazing directly next to him. This, of course, is Beatrice, who glows so brightly because she herself is looking at the center point of the wheels of heaven. As we will see in Dante's Cosmos, Everything which moves, moves because it's filled with a kind of giddy, childlike energy, a bright happiness to be in existence, what Dante calls love. As Dante puts it, it's the love which moves the sun and other stars. Beatrice, then, looks at this love at the center of the universe and is moved with love. And when she is moved by love, she becomes moving to Dante through her beauty. Thus, in the reflection of the radiance of her happiness, Dante himself is able to grow in his ability to see bliss. And Dante can feel himself being changed from the inside out as he looks at Beatrice, in the same manner, he says, that Glaucus was transformed. The reference Dante specifically uses is to Glaucus, yet another mythological character borrowed from Ovid. Appropriately, for Ovid wrote a book called The Metamorphoses, which tell all kinds of transformations. But here now in Paradiso, the place of transformation, Dante might even rely more on Ovid than he has relied on old Virgil. Because within the Metamorphoses, Ovid tells the delightful story about a fisherman who one day was fishing in a new location. He got a good haul of fish, pulled up his net, and laid the net and fish on the bright green grass to dry. But then the fish magically came back to life and started hopping about, and then they all flip-flopped their way back to the sea. Glaucus was confused. Here are Ovid's own words. "I stood dumbfounded, for a while not believing it, searching for the cause. Had some god done it? Or the juice of some herb? Yet what herb had such power?" I asked. And gathering some herbage in my hand, I bit what I had gathered with my teeth. My throat had scarcely swallowed the strange juice when suddenly I felt my heart trembling inside me, my breast seized with yearning for that other element. Unable to hold out for long, crying out, "Land I will never return to, goodbye," I immersed my body in the sea. The gods of the sea received me, thinking me worth the honor of their company, and asked Oceanus and Tethys to purge me of what was mortal in me. I was purified by them, and cleansed of sin by an incantation 9 times repeated. They ordered me to bathe my body in 100 rivers immediately. Streams from every side poured their waters over my head. So much I can tell of you, of those marvelous things, so much of them I remember. Then my mind knew more. When later I came to, my whole body was altered from what I was before, and my mind was not the same. Ovid tells then the metamorphosis of Glaucus, how he went from human to God, and in the process of transformation, began to long for new things, to swim with new speed, and to live in new depths, to say goodbye to the ordinary land which used to sustain him. In a similar way, then, Dante's Paradiso will be the tale of what he calls trasumanar, that is, to go beyond, trans, the human. But in a similar way to Glaucus, this transformation that takes place works from the inside out, and it is love which acts as the vehicle to make that something divine grow within. I'd like to conclude with one final observation. As I mentioned earlier, a lot of my students, when they hear these things for the first time, are a little weirded out. It sounds to them both extraordinary, but so extraordinary as to be alarming, too weird to be true. I like to quote them a few lines from one of my teachers at Notre Dame. We often, quote, "do not recognize some thoughts as medieval when it is presented to us in a more accurate form. It seems too daring, too sophisticated, too ideologically unfettered, too non-medieval. It can, even to those who understand it, come to seem as at least as compelling as our own examined or unexamined assumptions about the world," end quote. In other words, the fact is, Christianity at its roots is an extraordinary religion, which makes exceptional claims and the greatest demands. It promises a bliss, a pleasure, a brilliance, which eye hath not seen nor ear heard. Despite the difficulty inherent to the project, Dante's goal was to create a poem so exceptionally moving, in fact, the greatest thing which had ever been written, with the hope that it could at least gesture at what was above, or as he puts it, his poem might lead to migliori voci, better voices. Dante prays, then, if he could get just a glance of this beauty out of the corner of his eye. if he could hear just one note sung by the choirs of saints, and then if he could get a fraction of that vision into the world's most magnificent poem, if he could just get one tiny dying ember out of heaven's ocean of fire, it would still be so great and dazzling that it would set the world on fire. Poca favilla gran fiamma seconda.